The Dharma, incomparably profound and exquisite, is rarely met with even in hundreds of thousands of millions of kalpas. We now can see it, hear it, accept and hold it. May we realize the true mind of the Tathagata. Today is day 5 of this 7-day sesshin here at Mountain Gate in August 2017. Tomorrow is the last day of August. And we're looking into soon into the Labor Day weekend. And I'd like to continue sharing with you some of the teachings of Nakagawa Soen Roshi from the book Endless Vow, the Zen Path of Soen Nakagawa. Soen Roshi was the abbot of Ryutakuji, which literally translates into Dragon Swamp Temple. And he was renowned as an extraordinary Zen teacher. His dream was to bring Zen to America, one of the most favorite places that he liked to hike and stay in hermitages in, and quoted any number of times was Daibosatsu Ridge in Japan, meaning Great Bodhisattva Ridge. And today there is Daibosatsu Monastery in the Catskill Mountains in New York State in the United States. And it's been there for many, many years. It has had some challenging history, but now I believe the person at the helm, Shinge Roshi, is a quite authentic, quite wonderful, quite fully trained, quite ethical human being, and the Dharma teacher with high standards. So what originally may have come out of the swamp has enormous potential now. The person that actually started Daibosatsu Monastery in New York State was Edo Shimano, who was a student of Nakagawa Soen Roshi. Shinge Roshi also herself trained with Soen Roshi, and so she goes back to the original master. He also was the first teacher that Roshi Philip Keblo had when he went to Japan. And so we have a connection with Soen Roshi as well, and in addition, we have another connection with Soen Roshi because his Dharma name, Mitta, is the same as mine, although mine is pronounced differently. Mitra is pronounced in the Sanskrit way. Mitta is how it is pronounced in Japanese. So we have gone fairly far through the book at this point, and now he is at a point where he is teaching. He's been authorized to teach. He's completed his training, his formal training under Genpo Yamamoto, who was another foremost Zen master in Japan. And to his credit, as was mentioned before, Soen Roshi was also continuing his training under Daien Sogaku Harada Roshi. And it is through that connection that Keblo Roshi was taken to train with Daien Sogaku, and whom he considers, or considered, because Keblo Roshi is no longer alive, is his foremost teacher of Zen. So now we're at the point in the book where it is part 2, 1951 to 1959, early years as abbot. And he was abbot of Ryutakuji Monastery in Mishima, Japan. And he has already been to Los Angeles, where he finally met face to face his old friend, Nyōgen Senzaki, who was basically the first residential Japanese Zen monk in America. And by the time Soen Roshi met him, he was teaching in Los Angeles. had a small group of students there, including some Americans and some Japanese. He has a note here for autumn 1951. Upon Daisetsu Suzuki's departure, although I missed his airplane, not knowing summertime, like daylight savings time, was over. So he's back in Japan. Corn is ripe in the fields approaching the airport. And then, in autumn 1951, also, he writes, mendicant descends to the village, moonless night. And another one, acorn hits my shoulder just before dawn. So he's clearly doing yaza, outdoors. And then there's a rather amusing one in winter 1951. In the chorus of snores, an American friend is also heard this frosty night. And one wonders if that might have been Kaplaroshi. There is a photograph that was just posted on Facebook of Kaplaroshi with Soen Roshi and also Bernard Phillips. He and Kaplaroshi were good friends and they went to Japan together at Yutakuji in 1953. The photograph is dated 1953. Then in July 1952, he writes this note. During a visit from Paul Reps, who was an author, an early author of Zen, a poet wandering through the world at Ryutakuji, and he has a little note then, traveler, watch out. And his haiku is, oppressive cloud, we talk about the atomic age. This is not long after the two atomic bombs were dropped on Japan by the United States in a valiant effort to finally stop the war. And it did, and it took a great number of Japanese lives with it, and I suspect there's a lot of radiation left in the country because of that. There's a fair amount of cancer in Japan these days. And then in July 1952, morning service offering its fragrance, a white lily. This is the early morning chanting in Rinzai Monastery, and no doubt at Ryutakuji. And here's one that would be nice to know a little bit more about. This is in July. At last, I have met my own cool star. At last, I have met my own cool star. Now, what could he have been meaning about this? At last, I have met my own cool star. And then, sweeping the monastery yard, autumn's sound deeper day by day. That was written in September 1952. And into the twilight zendo, maple leaves come dancing. The windows in Japan, certainly in that era, did not have screens. And when they opened, they were open. And if the wind blew the falling maple leaves, they were quite likely to come in the window. When I was doing Rohatsu Sesshin at Bukkokuji, up in northern Japan, not on the northern island, but on the northern side of the main island, in Obama, Japan, at Tangen Roshi's place in the middle of Sesshin, the windows, there's a great wide window, probably at least 6 feet square, maybe 8 feet square, in the zendo, and it was half open. And in the middle of Sesshin, the Roshi got up, I could hear him getting up on the tons and slamming the window all the way open. And it was snowing, and snow was coming in, and along with the icy wind. And of course, there was no heat in the zendo. This is traditional in Japan, where there's no real natural resources other than water, and so heating fuel is extremely expensive. Electricity is extremely expensive, and even in the most wealthy homes, there is normally only one room in the entire house that has any climate conditioning in it, and it's a wall unit that can either heat or cool. They have all kinds of spot heating things. They have the traditional kotatsu, which is the low table over a hibachi in the old days, and now it's got an electric grill under it to heat, and then you put this big fat comforter over the thing, and then a top on top of the comforter, and so you can pull the comforter over your knees and gain aspect of the heat that's generated from that electric grill underneath. And they have electric carpets, heated carpets. They have heated cushions. They have these little bed warmer things, electric bed warmer things that you can put in your bed to warm it up at night. Which has got to be miraculous, because when you stop and think about it, if you've ever been winter camping, living in Japan in the winter is just like an ongoing experience of winter camping. No wonder they have heated toilet seats. Otherwise, there's a little bit of a challenge sometimes rising from the toilet. You can get stuck to it. People just live with that because they have not had any choice. So when the windows are open and the snow is coming in, it's really not different from being outside and the snow blowing around you, because there is no heat inside. This is not to punish people, it just is how they have lived for centuries and grown inured to it, but for foreigners it can be a huge challenge. And then, December 1952, stars drift down, aligning themselves, Rohatsu Sesshin. That is, of course, the Sesshin that is common in most monasteries, most Zen monasteries. A Sesshin of 8 days, really, 7 days, 7 nights and 8 days, that mimics the original Sesshin, really, that retreat that the Buddha himself did when he vowed finally to go within himself and search for the answer that he had not found in ascetic practice or in the luxury of his home when he was growing up. And that's the model for our Sesshin in general, and in particular for our Rohatsu Sesshin, which is more stringent, more strict because of that. And then in January 1953, Old Mountain Monastery, this New Year's Day brightening. And in the spring, same year, basking in the sun, my 88-year-old teacher, budding branch of plum. And so we don't know whether it is his teacher, Gyempo, or whether it was his teacher as an old, ancient plum tree. Could they be different? This is one of the questions we can ask ourselves. And later he gets into something like this. In the spring of 1953, he writes, picked by an old woman's hand, herbs glow green. And he has a writing about this haiku. He says, that poem represents a world where plus and minus are one. Kitaro Nishida's philosophy describes the self-identification of absolute contradiction. To be dying is to be living, and to be living is to be dying. Death and life cannot be separated. Death and life cannot be separated. We think so, and we mourn the dead, unless we understand deeply what death is about. This is a big question. What is death about? What is life about? One Zen master's last poem was something like, birth and death, what's the fuss? Because we have ideas about what life means and what death means culturally. In our own heads, in our ideas, in our thoughts, we perceive them as separate and distinct, and that one may even be not so good. But what are they really? What are they really? To be dying is to be living, and to be living is to be dying. Death and life cannot be separated. They only have different names. When we talk about the spiritual realm, we may feel that it is a place where we go after we die. You talk to a Christian, they're either going to go to heaven or hell. The way we see it, heaven or hell is of our own making in this very moment in our own mind. We don't have to go somewhere else to be in heaven or to be in hell. What does happen after we die? Does happen after we die? It depends on how we lived and how clear we are when we die. I think about my brother's death, which was extraordinary. Unexpected the year before he died. He was 2 years younger than me, in the very best of health. And then it turned out he had this discrete tumor in his bladder. And there seemed to be no problem taking that out, removing the bladder just as a precaution, building him a new bladder out of his own intestinal tract, which is the latest and greatest way of doing it, so you don't have to take rejection drugs that you would have to take if you ended up having a pig's bladder in your body, which is the former traditional way to do it. And so he underwent that 10.5-hour surgery in which all this was done. And because he was in such good physical condition, he was given 2 courses of chemo before the surgery, which is pretty standard these days. They want to bring the tumor down or the cancer down to as small as it can be so that when they do cut you open, they don't spread it. And then they did the surgery, and then immediately after, he had 4 courses of chemo in fast succession, faster than normal, which should have knocked it all out. And 6 weeks after the last chemo ended, he was dead. But he met his dying with curiosity and openness. And his last words or to tell his wife that he loved her. Something he only said probably 4 times in their 40-year marriage. Nonetheless, he felt it all the time and she knew it. But he voiced it at the end to try to reassure her And then the next 4 hours afterwards, there was this feeling of slight confusion and slight grief, like, what's really going on here? And then it transformed into something indescribable that can only be voiced. And this word, or this combination of words, is so puny compared to the experience. Voiced as luminous transparency. This is beyond letting go, beyond utter presence. Beyond. And as a result of that, I have no doubt that my brother gained a profound awakening as the part of the process of dying. Because even though in American science we can measure to a certain degree the functions of the body, we cannot tell exactly when the moment of actual death occurs. And when you talk about death being living and dying being living and living being dying, is there an actual point? The Tibetans feel it can take days. And traditionally in Zen, we don't move the body for at least 3 days following the declaration of death by whoever does it, the doctor or the nurse or whoever, the medical examiner, because it can interfere with that dying process. What is it about? What is it about? When we talk about the spiritual realm, we may feel that it is a place where we go after we die. Most people think that we live in the actual world while we are alive, and that after we take the last breath, we somehow wander into a vague realm of the spirit. It is a great mistake to see two separate realms. Instead, where we live is in fact the spiritual realm, a realm of many billion worlds, which goes beyond 3, 4, or even infinite dimensions. Then the danger is that we might think that this is a realm that is empty and boundless. Watch out! It's all manifested right here at this moment. It is alive and kicking. We can't just sit there in the realm of absolute equality. At the same time that we experience a world where all is one, we see the world of differentiation. We need to be able to function in this world. There is a book called Collision with the Absolute, which is the story of a woman who went partway into the enlightenment experience and got stuck there for 11 years. She got stuck in emptiness for 11 years. She knew something was amiss, to the point where she went to visit a so-called Zen master who said he didn't know what was going on. And she said that he hadn't done a complete enough training. And she went to a psychiatrist who decided she was schizophrenic. And neither of these were true. And finally, after 11 years, she was able to complete the process, move into differentiation, and see form is emptiness and emptiness is form at the same time. And that is what we have to do. There's a very dangerous point in Zen practice where people begin to open to the absolute or emptiness. And they think that that's where they're supposed to be. That's enlightenment. It's not. It's only a step in the direction. We have to move through the whole process for it to be called enlightenment, and this is very, very important. In one of our chants, to encounter the absolute is not yet enlightenment, is what we chant. encounter the Absolute is not yet enlightenment. It is on the way, and it's enticing because it can feel so free and so empty and so like nothing else to do, right? Come home. Well, we're not. Not yet. We have to keep on going. We can't just sit there in the realm of absolute equality. At the same time that we experience a world where all is one, we see the world of differentiation, where not one thing is the same. The world of absolute differentiation is, as it is, a world of absolute equality. Here's an old woman, a grandmother, and this is referring back to that haiku. She's picking some herbs, and as soon as she picks them, new shoots come up. I did not intend to create a haiku expressing the Zen viewpoint, but this is how things really are. We often hear the phrase in the Heart Sutra, form is emptiness, emptiness is form. It is not just that form is a tangible realm and emptiness is a spiritual realm. These realms are not two, but one. Even if you realize they are one, you can still get trapped by the idea of oneness. The following poems express a similar feeling to the one about the old woman picking herbs. Wisteria blossoms, fading, Saha world. That's the world of suffering. An old bhikshuni, that's an old nun, with nothing to do, sneezes. Then in spring 1955, he says, how interesting that people in Japan continue to serve special treats while saying, we have nothing. There's no better greeting in the world than this. Truly, from the beginning, there is not a thing. From the very beginning, there has never been a single thing. We can do a calligraphy with that. From the very beginning, there's never been a single thing. We can say, what's this then? What's this then? Well, what is it? This is the abundant feast. Let me offer this to you as a New Year's treat. And then he goes in February 1955 to Los Angeles on his second visit to Nyōgen Senzaki. In the air from Tokyo to Los Angeles, this time he's not taking a boat. On February 5th, the 13th day of the lunar calendar, on my second visit to the United States, and he writes this haiku. Disc of the sun, disc of the moon, together in the clouds, spring begins. And then he has some interesting commentary about the United States. In Los Angeles, I hear, there are two cars for every five people, and there's something called a freeway that goes in two separate directions, each with two or three lanes with spiraling ramps. The drivers search for something called parking places. In the middle of the city, Japanese and American Buddhists establish a Zen hermitage centering around old man Nyōgen Senzaki. It seems Buddhism is still traveling eastward. I'm a guest here, a wandering wanderer doing nothing. And his haiku is car after car shining in the spring breeze. And I guess there's a woman who named Sekirin, we don't know whether she's Japanese or American, probably Japanese or Japanese-American. It sounds like a Buddhist name. And he writes, Sekirin has completed her vow to draw 500,000 images of Jizo Bodhisattva and has decided to extend her vow to 1,000,000. And his poem on this, embraced by the golden wind, all things bear fruit, round and full. Then he's back at Dear Takuji again, it looks like. When I took a walk on the mountain path around Ryutakuji with a Zen student from France named Manuel C., we were thrilled to have a clear view of Mount Fuji. We walked all the way up to the top of Mount Hakone. Neither of us had a single thing in our pockets or in our stomachs. We started to worry, and then suddenly, someone appeared. It was Kay, a priest from Atami. I was so struck by meeting him there. He lent us a Dream Hall note. What they called a 1,000 yen note, because it had a picture of meditation hut of Prince Shotoku, who was considered the first Buddhist in Japan. So we were able to return by bus. And he writes this, mountain peak at the height of winter, lucid serenity. It's rather interesting. There was a Zen monk, Sheng Yen is one of his Dharma heirs, who was traveling in China on foot in a very old time. He died in the 1950s after a beating by the Red Guards, actually a year after the beating by the Red Guards, and he was 119 years old. And there were records that showed that he was 119 years old when he died. But when he was much younger, he was traveling, and it was winter, I guess. And somehow in fording a stream, he got wet and was getting chilled and getting sick. And he found the ruins of a hut, and it was open to one side, and he was able to take some refuge in there and was increasingly ill. And suddenly there appeared a monk who cooked yellow rice for him, and had rice to cook, for that matter, and took care of him for several days until he was able to go on his own again. In the meantime, there was snow all around, and then the monk just disappeared without a trace. These things can be mysterious. A little bit like our Kuan Yin up there on the altar. Who found us, or we found her, or we both found each other. In the Toronto Chinatown, racing past hundreds of other figures, led by the man who owned the shop in which she was being sold. And he went straight to her. And as soon as he opened the box and showed us to her, we knew she was the one. These things can happen in mysterious ways. And then, May 8th, 1958, that was when I was graduating from high school. In the midst of Dawn Zazen on May 8th, we received a telephone call from Los Angeles that old man Nyogen, that's Nyogen Senzaki, who stirred up a Zen wind in America for more than half a century, has passed away. And of course, you remember that his name referred to Phantasm. And so he wrote this, Phantasm and Phantasm walk together, summer begins. And on the same day he wrote a letter to Nyogen Senzaki, already knowing that he had died. And here is the letter. This morning, as usual, we woke up at our 3:30 a.m. wake up. After morning service in the Dharma Hall, there were two dawn sittings. During the first sitting, I was in the Zendo with the monks, and then the attendant monk hurried up to me and informed me of a telephone call from Los Angeles. At that very moment, as though struck by a bolt of lightning, my mind was joined by yours. I heard Sister Shubin's lamenting voice, Brother Bai-O is clear. Okay. The faces Makanini-san and Seiko-san seem visible to me. These are all people in Los Angeles. And he writes, I am joining in your meeting with one mind. And he wrote that in English, that part. During the second sitting, I called the monks to Doksan. The first one who came in was a young novice monk, 19 years old, who joined the monastery early this April from the countryside of Shikoku Island. Although he just started Zazen very recently, he's been getting into samadhi quickly and deeply. Completely filled with samadhi joy, he told me that though he hadn't slept for the past 4 nights and days, he felt as clear as ever. And so these are some testing questions. What about before your birth? What about after death? Even these questions he answered clearly, one by one. Indeed, this must be the working of his karma, not only in this lifetime, but life after life. It's important not to get any ideas about ourselves as a result of hearing that. Some people have been working for lifetimes in certain ways with certain karma that has come to fruition in this one, allowing them to come to some level of awakening very rapidly. Others of us may have taken deep vows that brought us into circumstances in this life that challenged us, that gave us the opportunity to do significant bodhisattva training. And so it may take longer, but there is such important work being done in the meantime. Please remember that Kensho is not the be-all and end-all. It's an important point in practice, and the practice appropriately done will eventually result in it if we give ourselves to it. But it's vital not to override conditioning that may challenge one in one sitting, but to work with that conditioning, to let it go. This is all part of the long maturation, which is vital for someone on the path to awakening. It is possible to get Kensho too early. It's also possible to get Kensho by shoving everything under the carpet that one would need to work through to be a fully realized human being. And when that happens, it may be a deep enough insight to be able to work on subsequent koans. But that behavior, that conditioning has not yet been addressed and is still operant. And this is not so great. That conditioning needs to be cleared out, needs to be reckoned with, needs to be worked with, needs to be dissolved, so that no matter what level of mind state we've been able to achieve, we can live it in our day-to-day life. It's not that we come into the Zendo and practice and we go into Sanzen and pass a koan and go back out into our daily life and act like a shithead. That doesn't work. That's not the point of Zen. And this is vital to recognize. This is why in Rinzai Zen, the practice is long and challenging, but effective if we're willing to really take it and run with it. The fourth person to come in was Monk Edo, who was Edo Shimano. And his koan happened to be Tosotsu's Three Barriers. If you realize your true nature, you are free from life and death. These are the questions as part of that koan. When your eyes are closed, in other words, when you've died, how can you be free from life and death? If you're free from life and death, you'll know where you're going. When the four elements are disintegrated, where will you go? This is all part of that koan. On this occasion, at this time, we thoroughly examined and clarified this particular koan, as I believe this is the best way to express our gratitude to you, Nyogen Suzaki. After finishing Doksan, I went up to Genpo Roshi's quarters and informed him of your departure. He was lying on his bed, but said he was a reincarnate and will work even harder for the Dharma now that he is without hindrance. What does that mean? What can it mean? I completely agree with him. Nyogen, Nyoho, which is his name, his Buddhist name, which translates as like a phantom, like a phantasm, like Dharma. Please guide us on our path and in our practice with all your might. Please give us your encouragement in our pursuit of Buddha's incomparable way. At 6 a.m., we took our breakfast. When you visited here in 1955, you sat at this very place, and we ate rice with azuki beans to toast your safe return to the United States. Just as we did that time with some 20 monks and serious lay students, we are dedicating ourselves to the Buddha's way. Please rest assured. After breakfast, I announced your departure to all the monks and lay students. Three of us, Manuel C. from France, Monk Edo, and I, offered incense and flowers from my mother's hut. And we all listened to the lecture you'd given at the Tuesday talk at the Los Angeles Zendo on September 19th, 1952, which had been recorded by Sister Seiko. I was deeply moved by what you said about the way of renunciation. Today I will go to Koyama Zenkai. That's a group of lepers who meet for Zen practice. After the evening Han, we will hold a memorial service for you, chanting the great compassionate Dharani, and we will listen to your recorded voice, searching for the treasure. Searching for the treasure. Isn't this what we're doing in the Zendo? Searching for the treasure. As I think more about our unthinkable karmic encounter during this lifetime, many scenes and images flow through my mind like a picture scroll. I was getting ready to send cherry blossoms to your bedside for comfort, but as usual, being a poor letter writer, it turned out to be too late. However, now I feel it was all right. This matter, with a capital M, is beyond correspondence and beyond words and letters. And I have even come to think that in the final analysis, mind alone is good enough. Last night I was in Mishima for the Zen meeting, held every seventh day of the month. I asked my friend Mrs. Mayo, who will soon perform the no dance Tomoe, to sing a passage from it. And so here's this passage. Falling petals know it is fundamentally empty. Flowing water knows it has no fixed mind. Mind clears all by itself. Because who is there, really, to clear it? Who is there, really, to clear it? After that was over, I gave a talk on karma and fundamental emptiness. I assume your departure may have taken place just around that time. Japanese time, 9 p.m., May 7th. Los Angeles time, 5 a.m., May 7th. And May 26th, 1958, upon the departure of Manuel C. on his way back to France by ocean liner after completing a year and a half of life in the monk's hall, this haiku. On the deck, a thought of midnight sun, I whisk a bowl of tea. And in July, that same year, in an airplane on my way to a Zen hermitage called Tozin, which is moving eastward, in Los Angeles, soaring through the sky for a day of the deceased, vast America. And in September, the departure of the boat I was going to take back from Los Angeles to Yokohama, Japan, has been delayed 3 days until October 1st. We moved Choro on Zendo, which was Zen, Senzaki's meditation hall, to Shubin's house across the street. Nothing of the Zendo is left. And he writes this: autumn light fills the room, vacancy. And then October 1st, 1958, at 5 p.m., Dharma friends, both Japanese and American, assembled for a final period of Zazen. Chanting the four great vows, we placed the urn with the ashes of old man Yogen into a monk's traveling bag. Cars formed a procession to Wilmington Port in Los Angeles. The disk of the evening sun was reflected up and down the freeway. And he writes this: friends' faces reluctant to part. Golden wind. So he must have gone back to take care of the last chanting and to take care of Senzaki's ashes. October 13th, 1958, Buddhism first arrived in Japan on this day, in the 13th year of Emperor Kinmei's reign, 552. On this voyage, I also brought 30,000 images of Jizo Bodhisattva. From among the 1 million images of Jizo Bodhisattvas, the Sekirin has painted in fulfillment of her vow. I've been sending these Bodhisattvas out over the water as the ship speeds toward the west. Meanwhile, three American Zen friends who left Los Angeles on October 7th on the boat after mine are now floating somewhere in the Pacific. Coming and going. Coming and going. We are all it, with a capital I, in the Dharma ocean of thusness. Now I make a bowl of tea. And then in January 1959, he writes, the so-called 12 causes and effects, the transmigration of birth and death, all are originally pure and empty. How auspicious. The 12 signs renew a cycle, year of emptiness. And then, fierce storm. In the midst of the storm, first sunrise of the year. Isn't it like that? Isn't it like that? A lot to consider, and I hope you take it in and don't mull it over in words, but reach deep within yourself to try to understand some of these things, these deep things that Soen Nakagawa Roshi has written. That's the end of his first session, his first 10 years of teaching in Japan. And the next section is part three, Teaching in the West, 1959 to 1972. And we'll take that one up tomorrow. In the meantime, form is emptiness. Emptiness is form. Living and dying, dying and living. For most of my childhood, well, for all of my childhood, and up until the point where, at some point when I was doing Zazen, formerly at the Rochester Zen Center, I had a massive fear of heights. When my brother and I were living in, we'd just gone to live in Cleveland Heights, Ohio. I was in sixth grade, he was in fourth grade, and they weren't quite finished with building our house, so there was a tall ladder that went all the way up to the roof. And we started playing on it. I could not get past the second rung of the ladder without this intense panic coming up in me. And that's how it was. I used to jerk awake in the middle of the night with this dream where I was starting to fall. And when you're at the Rochester Zen Center or any Zen training center, at least traditional style, there's not a lot of time to sleep. And I was getting rather annoyed by this constant waking up in the middle of the night with this nasty dream. And I thought, it's only a dream. Let's just see what happens if I let it go, because I was always stopping it right when I was starting to fall. And so the next time the dream came up, I stayed present with it, and I started to fall, and then I blacked out in the fall. So I copped out in that way and disgusted with myself. The next time the dream came, I fell. I could see clearly these massive black rocks down below on the edge of the ocean. But as I fell, somewhere before I landed, because the dream ended, so, but because it didn't need to continue after that, somewhere in the midst of the fall, I realized profoundly, deeply, that it did not matter if I was dashed to death on the rocks below or if I survived, that there was no difference between life and death. There is no difference between life and death, except in appearances. And I never had the dreams after that. And from then on, I was able to hike high into the mountains. Eventually, I was able to work for Barkman Engineering in Santa Fe and climb up to the rooftops of buildings to examine heating and cooling systems. The fear of heights was gone. There was no difference between living and dying. There is no difference between living and dying. Now put that in your pipe and smoke it, as they say. I leave that with you. Thank you for listening. We'll stop now and recite the four vows.